Welcome, I am Chico Sundermann, and today I want to present the results of our SPSC submission with the title Yet Another Textual Variability Language, a Community Effort Towards a Unified Language. While the development process was joint effort with researchers from around the globe, this particular submission is a cooperation of the University of Ulm, the Johannes Kepler University of Linz, and the Technical University of Braunschweig. We hope that by the end of this video we can convince you that our proposal is not already doomed to be yet another variability language. Let's start with an outlook. In our work in this video, we present an initial proposal for a unified language, the Universal Variability Language. The primary purpose of this language is to be used for exchange between variability modeling tools, but we designed it specifically to be understandable by humans and even be edited in ordinary text editors. We also get into the details of the language later, but the focus of our work lies on the approach of designing the language in a joint effort with the community and in particular the Modova initiative. The Modova initiative has the goal of finding a variability language that is widely adopted by the community, and they already produced a variety of contributions towards that goal. Within the Modova initiative, we developed UVL with the idea to incorporate as much feedback of the community as possible in the different stages of language development. This hopefully increases the chances of UVL being widely adopted by the community, and in this video we want to share our journey with you. But why do we even need a unified language? Typically, we have a configurable system like this product line of different servers. In general, there are some requirements on how components or features of these servers can be combined. Such requirements can be specified using a variability model, or here, a feature model. Those are then stored in a textual format to be used in tools for variability modeling. The problem is that not a single, but many variability languages are considered in literature. Here we can see this same feature model in 13 different notations, and many of those notations are used in different variability modeling tools. So why is this multitude of notations a problem? If we just use one tool, one format is sufficient. However, in general, each tool has its own advantages and capabilities. So another tool may have a nice analysis for our feature model we want to use. However, this is not directly possible, as the other tool may accept another language. And to translate our format into the other format, we require a parser. It is possible that there is not a suitable parser and we need to implement our own, which induces additional work. The same goes if we want to use another variability model from another language. We cannot use it directly in our tool, but require an additional parser. If one format was widely adopted in the community, the described effort to use or even implement new parsers would be greatly reduced. However, it is not trivial to establish a format. There is no guarantee that a language is widely adopted. In this case, we would still have the problem of needing transformations between multiple and now even more formats. So speaking in this comic, we want to prevent the scenario on the right, where we just increase the number of available formats. To decrease the chances of that happening, we did the following for UVL. First, we provide open access repositories for UVL containing the language design in a serializable format, a parser library, documentation and examples on how to use UVL. And furthermore, we also provide licenses for wide usage of UVL, even in commercial settings. Second, and more importantly, UVL is the result of a joint effort with the community and in particular the Modova initiative. Modova was initiated in 2018 by David Benavides and already had 4 workshops with overall 25 contributions. The goal of the initiative is that the community widely adopts a single variability language. Our proposal, the UVL, is a direct result from the efforts of the Modova initiative in the last 3 years and a possible candidate for the widely adopted language. In the following, I will present the development process of UVL separated in 4 phases. In the vast majority of the development, the feedback and the input of the community was and is incorporated. First, we gathered requirements based on previous work on designing languages. Second, we evaluated the preferences of the community on those identified concepts. Third, we proposed 2 language variants for further evaluation. And fourth, we evaluated which variant is preferred and how well it is accepted. Let's start with gathering the requirements. First of all, the design of UVL is influenced by many works. One prevalent previous work is a collection of application scenarios provided by several researchers in the domain. Overall, the researchers collected 14 usage scenarios and presented them to the community. Then, the community rated the scenarios by their usefulness. This was summarized in the work of Berger and Colley. Overall, we considered 5 out of 14 language scenarios for the UVL. The other 9 were either not rated as useful by the community for the language design, or relevant for other aspects of variability modeling and not the language design itself. A variability language should be suitable for exchange between different tools. Thus, it should be specified in a serializable format like a context-free grammar and optimally come with a library for reading and writing the syntax. Another aspect is mapping features to implementation artifacts. This could be realized by, for example, tying lines of codes to specific features, or with a more simplified version where we only differentiate between features that correspond to the implementations or ones that are just used for structuring. The language should also be readable by humans and easy to understand. This can be supported by providing useful documentation and examples. Also, there should not be a large overhead, which increases the size when storing variability models. In general, large variability models are hard to overview. It should be possible to first decompose models in smaller units, which are easier to edit, and then allow composition of those separated units for analysis and configuration over the entire model. Together for our requirements, we analyzed existing variability languages. The idea is to identify popular concepts that are also familiar to the community. We analyzed which concepts are included in all or just some languages. Also, we examined in which ways the concepts are modeled in different languages. In the next step, we analyzed the preferences of the community on the identified concepts. We performed a questionnaire at the Modovar 2020 with 20 participants. And here, the participants could choose which concepts should be included or excluded and choose their preferred way on modeling different concepts. So first, which language features should be included in an initial version of UVL? The first concept we evaluated are feature attributes, which are non-functional properties that can be attached to features, like, for example, providing a price for each feature. Here, the majority of participants stated that feature attributes should be included, so we included it. An abstract feature is used for structuring purposes and does not correspond to any implementation artifact. Here, the results were similar as for attributes, so we included it in the initial design. The same goes for a mechanism that allows composing of feature models. So we included this mechanism as well. It may also be helpful to have an extension mechanism for two specific data, like for example to specify the layouting in a graphical editor, as done in Feature IDE. Here, the participants were split on whether to include it or not, so we decided to exclude it for an initial version, but consider an integration for a later version. Still, due to the flexibility of feature attributes, two specific data can already be specified in UVL with feature attributes. In some cases, it may be useful to specify whether a feature should be selected or deselected by default when configuring. However, the participants were again split on whether to include it or not, so we decided to exclude it for the initial version. However, default selections can also be expressed using feature attributes. It may make sense to store certain configurations, like, for example, popular Linux distributions in the variability model. However, most participants would not include this concept in the initial version, so we excluded it. If we compose feature models, it is possible that we do not require every detail of a submodel. In this case, we could use a feature model interface that hides certain information from the composed model. However, the participants voted that it should not be included in the first version, so we excluded it. Let's also take a look at some examples where participants voted on their favorite way to model a concept. When analyzing the variability languages, we found two locations to store cross-tree constraints, next to the feature as seen on the left, or separated from the tree as seen on the right side. The participants could now vote which of both concepts they prefer. Here, they preferred cross-tree constraints separated from the tree. We also identified 3 ways to specify keywords. They can be either long or written out, so like for alternative, or abbreviations where we take alt for alternative, or symbols which are typically similar to grammar notations, which can be seen on the right here. Here, the participants preferred long keywords. We also found 3 different ways to specify hierarchy. using nesting with either indentation or brackets, or use references to the children's feature names. The results were similar for nesting with indentation and references. So we decided to propose two versions of UVL, one using nesting, one using references. After we analyzed the preferences of the community, we made our language proposal. Based on the insights, we proposed two different versions for further evaluation. The main difference here is the modeling of hierarchy. On the left side, we see the hierarchy specified using nesting, on the right side, using references. Then we took both variants to evaluate the acceptance of the community. We performed another questionnaire analyzing which variance is seen more favorably and how well UVL is accepted overall. The participants could give scores and provide textual explanations. We also left it optional to provide a name to encourage negative feedback. Here we can see the results for both versions. Scores were given by the participants on a scale from 1 to 6, where 6 is very good. We can see that the variant using nesting is seen more positively, so we decided to go with this version for UVL. Also, we can see that 14 out of 16 participants gave a score of at least 4 for UVL. So, we argue that the vast majority of participants sees UVL positively. Here we can see the resulting language design. UVL uses nesting to specify hierarchy and long keywords instead of abbreviated ones or symbols. Furthermore, cross-tree constraints are separated from the tree. Statements are ended with new lines. To specify the parent and child relationship, you can use either cardinality, like choose 1 out of 3 or 2 out of 6, or group types such as mandatory, optional, alternative, or or. Constraints are limited to propositional logic in contrast to, for example, first-order logic. The language contains feature attributes, such as a log level here. The language supports abstract features and composition, so other feature models such as the file system here can be referenced. Let's also take a look at a more detailed feedback of the community on the language design. The vast majority of participants can represent their models in UVL. Also, most claim that UVL can be easily integrated in their tool and is not too complex. However, there are some concerns on the style and the suitability for teaching and learning. One reason for the negative feedback here may be the comparison to graphical editors, which are typically easier to use and also to learn. Nevertheless, we still consider the concerns for future iterations of UVL. One way to support understandability and suitability for teaching are designated editors, syntax highlighting and linters, for example. In this video, we showed the design process of UVL, which was a joint effort of the community. We first gathered requirements to present them to the community and evaluated preferences, made a language proposal, and evaluated the acceptance. The results give a first indicator that UVL may be a promising candidate for a unified language in the future. Nevertheless, we need further evaluations in the future and also need to apply UVL in practice to measure its design and ultimately reach the goal of a community standard.